Buenos días a todos, gracias por venir. Hoy tenemos la suerte de contar con la presencia del profesor Bernard Malvert, gracias al Centro de Investigación Operativa y a la Cátedra Santander de Eficiencia y Productividad. Bernard es profesor del Instituto de Investigación Industrial en Austria y profesor de la Universidad de Viena en el Departamento de Economía. Y bueno, se ha dedicado en los últimos años a investigar sobre temas de eficiencia y productividad en distintos sectores. Hoy en concreto nos trae una charla sobre energías renovables y plantas generadoras de biogás y un análisis de su eficiencia. Así que estamos muy agradecidos. Thank you, Bernard, for all.
You're welcome. It's a pleasure to me with you today and to present my work here. So I've been here since the beginning of last week, and I enjoy being here, enjoy the city, and enjoy the Spanish way of life, which is in many respects different from life in Central Europe. And I, of course, I enjoy very much being here at this institute because it's specialized to efficiency and productivity analysis. We do not have such a specialized center in Vienna, although we have a small group working on this, but it's of course not comparable with a whole center, and of course not we are not so specialized and not so skilled and not so familiar with data analysis like Juan is and Jesus Pastor, which I consider as leading scientists in this field of research, and I'm really very grateful to have the opportunity to cooperate with you and, of course, to present my work here. The title of my work is here, Projected Size Subsidies, Technical Efficiency of Austrian Biogas Plants. You may think that this is poorly applied work, but nevertheless we not only use and apply advanced DEA methods, but we also derived it and or modified a little bit the estimator, which has been published by Jesus Pastor and a co-author of him, and there's still some open questions also concerning the method. And I would be grateful to discuss these questions with you. So there is, you see, room for questions, comments from your side. It's not still preliminary work. Yeah. Although we have already submitted it at the Journal of Energy Policy or Energy Policy Journal. Let me say a couple of words about the backgrounds to introduce it simply to you, since I guess you are not so deep involved in biogas or energy economic, energy policy research, so this must be something new for you. Well, the background is simply, or let me say, the origin is simply simply the climate and energy targets formulated by the European Union, or better say by the European Council, which are parts of the so-called 2020 targets. Yeah. The EU says that they want to increase the energy efficiency by 20% till the year 2020, and would like to reduce greenhouse gas emissions by 20%. And the third aspect is now key for me, and the starting point of my research that the EU would like to increase or to reach the 20% level of gross final energy consumption from renewable energy carriers, you know, or renewable energy sources. Yeah, and one renewable energy source is biogas. So this fits to this group. This general goal has split it up or broken down to goals for individual nations or member states. I'm sure that also one for Spain, but I'm not familiar with that. I focus on Austria here, and the target for Austria is simply to increase the energy consumption produced from renewable energy sources to 34% to 34%. One element of this strategy is biogas. Yeah, I will introduce you biogas, tell you what biogas is later on. But first, let's have a look on interesting statistics, which shows you that we had really a biogas boom. Here, this graph shows you the number of biogas plants we have in Austria, which operates in Austria, and the total amount of installed capacity in kilowatt electricity power. And you see we had, at the beginning of the 2000s years, we had an increase, you know, we had something like a biogas boom, a lot of new biogas plants went into operation, but since the general framework, especially in terms of subsidies, investment subsidies, changed in 2007, this boom stopped, and the in some sense the whole branch, this industry stagnated. Yeah, and this is really a problem. By the way, most of the plant operators are very small companies with a little equity capital. Most of these plants, or the investment into these plants, were financed by loans, not by their own operators' capital, their financial capital. Yeah. So you can imagine that this is a problem for their able to survive, for the ability to survive. And when then the framework changed, the climate to invest became unfriendly to them. Also the prices of the inputs increased. Operating costs increased. Nowadays the costs and the costs, operating costs, the production costs for biogas is much higher than the average market prices for electricity. This is a little this is compensated by the Green Energy Act, which guarantee a feed-in tariff, but this guarantee will soon expire. It expires after 13 years, and the question is, what's then? Yeah, what can be the future of the whole branch of this future? But you see, the production costs or the feed-in tariff they get is much higher than the contemporary average price. So if this feed-in tariff is not anymore guaranteed, then they will run into a loss soon. Yeah, so they would suffer loss, and probably they have to close
down the plants. And against this background, also the increasing prices, lack of capital or money for research and development, here it's an increase in operating efficiency and optimization of the whole of the processes within these plants, the production processes, are really needed. Yeah. Then, as I mentioned before, otherwise the plants would get simply bankrupt. And this is an interesting field for efficiency analysis, as you can imagine. Yeah. What we want to do is simply, or what we do simply here in this research, we try to quantify technical inefficiency, assessing plants with respect of their technical efficiency in this stage. I also want to, out of this research, want to generate some advices, yeah, for the operators. What can they do to optimize their plants? And of course, we apply here data management analysis to benchmark the individual firms to identify those plants who are operating efficiently and can be an example for other inefficient plants. How can they do? What can they improve? And so on and so forth. And of course, we'd like to identify sources of inefficiency. Internal sources within the plant, but also sources of inefficiency coming from the environment where the plants operate. Let's have a quick look to the existing literature. This is almost a comprehensive list. So you see there aren't many studies published so far. None of them, by the way, are published in top journals. And all of them, or most of them, suffer from an incomplete set of inputs and outputs. So, technically speaking, we have the problem of, or we face the problem of omitted variable bias, by the way. And many studies cover just a small sample. Yeah, so they are really incomplete, and therefore we can say that we are the first who comprehensively evaluate efficiency of this special type of renewable energy plants based on a comprehensive sample and or on a huge sample, really representative sample, and based on a comprehensive set and complete set of inputs and outputs. So now I'd like to introduce you the process of the processes taking place in a power gas plant, since it's a little unusual, yeah. It's not like solar power, where the sun comes down, or the and then there's a panel which produces energy directly. No, it's not different. Actually, here power gas plants are in some sense comparable with regular gas power plants. Working on off or using fossil fuel, yeah. But instead of using fossil fuels, these plants in a first stage produce the gas, yeah, which is then used to produce electricity and heat. Yeah. So the upper part of this figure shows in the schematic way, or I chose this scheme more or less of the biogas production. And the second half here shows you what is then done with this crude biogas. Yeah? What do they do is they take feedstock or substrate, which comes actually from agriculture, like maize or animal manure, energy crops, or they take also organic waste. Yeah, organic waste. Yeah? This type of we call this feedstock or substrate. Yeah, they take this. Yeah. First they store it a little bit, and then they take it and fill it in so-called digesters, yes? And in these digesters, there starts a conversion process, which converts, more or less automatic, the feedstock into a type of gas. Yes, this is in some sense similar. You can observe this if you you keep fruit too long, then you know they start in your household they start smelling, and they you know, yeah, there is something. Yes, yeah, this is in any process in when you have organic things. Yeah, but this gas is here. This doesn't go to the atmosphere. But this here, it is kept, yeah. It's stored here, and this stored crude gas then is. By the way, the most important element of within this gas, actually, it's a conglomerate of gas. But the most important element is CH4, which is methane, and methane is that what you actually use when you take the fossil gas, yeah? Yeah, this is the element in principle what we usually get, and you use it in your household, yeah, for heating, for example, or for cooking, yeah. This is and the biogas is something similar like that, yeah. There is also some other elements in. This has to be excluded before it goes into a gas engine, yeah. And the gas engine is, of course, where this gas is burned, yeah. And this gas engine is, of course, connected to a generator, yeah, which produces the electricity, yeah. This part here is more or less is actually the same, similar what you. See in a regular gas power plant, yeah, using fossil gas, yeah, this part, yeah, here, and of course not only electricity is produced, but since this engine here is a combined heat power engine, it produces also heat, which can be used. For heating rooms, for example, or can be used for process heat and so on and so forth. And as an alternative, you can purify the gas to biomethane, which can be injured into a public grid in a public gas grid, yes, as a substitute of fossil gas, yeah, and this electricity goes into the public electricity grid, and yeah, and the heat can be used like in the same context like district heating. A company, yeah? But parts of the heat and the produced electricity are needed to keep the process running. Therefore, we have here also, you see this arrow here. The process needs as input also electricity, which can be produced internally or can be taken from the public electricity network. And it needs also heat, process heat, to keep this the processes here running in the digester. Yeah. So okay, summarize the set of inputs used and outputs produced here in this list. Of course, we need the feedstock as the basis to produce the biogas, the crude biogas. Then, of course, we need capital, which means simply the capital stock, the facilities, the chesters, CHP, so the whole plant, facilities in the whole plant. And of course, you need some labor input to maintain the process, to supervise it. Yeah, and the process consumes electricity, heat, and of course, also other costs like insurance, maintenance, and so on and so forth. These are the six inputs we take in our evaluation. And the plant produces electric energy, yeah, and sells it to the market. It produces heat, yeah, which can be also sold to the market, and some of them produces the biomethane, which is the purified, which is a gas, which is a substitute of fossil gas. And finally, and this can be debated, but I think we have good arguments for this, some plants which use waste as substrate, processes this waste. Yeah, this like in any plant which handles waste, your waste you generate in your households, for example, or better say the part of this household waste, the organic ones, which is based on and the plant handles this waste. Yeah? Although it goes as an input in the process, we would like to consider it as an undesirable input or actually as an output in our modeling. Why do we do this? Because actually, from the business economics point of view, the operators gain revenue out of this. Yeah? They do not take the waste for free, but they make money out of that. Yeah, yeah. Like any regular waste processing firm. Yeah. And therefore, they have an incentive to maximize this. And because they have an incentive to maximize the amount of waste they use, we consider it as an output. Yeah, this argument is based on Cook et al. Yeah, who suggest that everything which should be everything which the operator or the firm management tries to maximize should be considered as an output in the EA context, and everything a firm, a management operator would like to minimize should be considered as an input. Okay?
For some of the outputs, the electricity sold and the biomethane sold, it's fixed or they can play on the percentage that they put in electricity generation and the percentage?
Yeah, they can substitute, of course, because they can decide, maybe we should one. They can either transfer the crude biogas to a gas engine, which is then connected to a generator, or they can put it to a gas purification facility and produce biomethane. Yeah. Of course, the same amount of gas cannot used for both. Yeah. Either you can, or you can burn it. Yeah, then you get the medication and so on. Or you can inject it into the network and transfer it to a firm or to a household. You can take it into your kitchen to cook, or you can prepare the heat you need for your rooms and so on.
But how they solve this problem? Because it's complex according to the demand, according how they solve this problem.
If they are clever enough, they optimize. They try to maximize the revenue they can get out of there. And it depends, of course, on the relative prices, whether they produce more electricity or more biomethane. Yeah, but I can tell you that for biomethane, no tariff is guaranteed by law. They have to sell it to the market and compete with fossil fuel suppliers. Yeah, therefore, most of them get lower prices, or they can establish a label, say biomethane. This is green. This is ethical, from the ethical point of view, correct. And then they may find customers who are ready to pay a higher price than for fossil fuel. Yeah. Whereas for most plants, the feed-in tariff for electricity is still guaranteed by the law. Yeah, by the law. And therefore most plants prefer producing energy, electricity. So producing electricity. But as I mentioned before, sooner or later, for many plants, the guaranteed feed-in tariff will expire. Yeah, and then they have to do something. Yeah, either they produce other products for the market, or I don't know what, or they simply stop working, yeah, because they go bankrupt. This is really a problem. And at the moment, and this is the political background. At the moment, there is a political discussion, not only in expert circles, but also in the public, in the media, even in the media, about this guaranteed feed-in tariffs, because this feed-in tariffs has to be financed by somebody. Yeah? And so far, it is financed from fees households pay. Yeah? So what we, this is like a tax we pay as households. Yeah? Yeah? In addition to our electricity price. Yeah? And this goes via a clearing agency to the renewable energy producers, not only to biogas plants, but also to wind plant operators, to solar power plant operators, and so on and so forth. This is a pool of money which are distributed. This is since because the production costs are still higher, the production costs for the bioenergy producers. You know, they cannot compete with normal of fossil fuel-based energy producers. Yes, that's the problem. Yeah. Yeah, this is just a first look where the biogas plants are located within Austria, and how many. We distinguish two type of power plants, biogas power plants, agricultural power plant and waste power plants. Agricultural power plants use only substrates coming from agriculture, no waste. Yeah, and the waste power plants take mainly waste, but as co-substrates also a little feedstock from agriculture. Yeah, why do we distinguish these two types? First of all, the set of outputs are different. Set of inputs and outputs are a little different. The processes are a little different. And but the legal framework is different. Yeah, since the waste power plants have to clean the waste before they can put them into the digester, and there is it's a little more work to do, and more facilities are needed, more capital needed, and also more energy is needed to process waste. Yeah, here you see a little a table of. Descriptive statistics, yeah, this may give you a little feeling about the domain of the variables. Featured, you see, they are in some sense relatively heterogeneous. So in terms of size and also in terms of substrates they use. And so on and so forth. Also in terms of age, in terms of number of digesters and so forth. So now I'm moving on to the methodological part of my work. Which is probably the part which is mostly interesting for you, since we do not apply a simple CCR model or a basic DA model, or PCC, CCR, Banker, Charles Cooper, Charles Rhodes, or something like that. No. We would like to include also the we get. Yeah. In the first stage at the beginning of our research, we estimated efficiency using the basic models. Yeah. But then we from the results we saw that we have really remarkable huge. Or we get really remarkably huge and large numbers of slacks, yeah, which we would not like to ignore, because they are, as I said, they are really remarkable. We would like to incorporate it into our efficiency analysis, and this can be done. Based on the range directional model, but on an advanced version of range directional model. Here I'm showing you the basic model, the R&D model, which is in some sense related to directional distance function. You see we maximize beta, which is the inefficiency measure. By the way, this is the input-oriented version. You see we like to reduce the inputs used and keep the outputs constant. That's simply because we think that the operator can control the inputs much easier than the outputs. they produce, and this is, as I said, similar to directional distance function, but as a direction vector, we use this R, which is the range of possible improvements of the ETH, of the ETH input. Yeah, and we take the CRS version, the VRS version, and the non-increasing returns to scale version, also to do a test or to figure out whether an individual plant operates in constant returns to scale or in the increasing or decreasing returns to scale soon. We would like to estimate not only technical efficiency, but would also like to decompose it in pure technical efficiency and scale efficiency or scale inefficiency. This can be done. And well, one nice property, or this estimator or this model has a couple of nice nice properties. We find it very nice that it is translation invariant and it can deal with zero values in the input and output side, contrary to SPM. And if we take the outcomes, especially the inefficiency measure. Yeah. By the way, this picture shows you the way how this how this model works. So how this model works. Contrary to basic CCR or BCC model, the model defines a so-called ideal point, and the projection, the direction of the projection is towards or in direction to this ideal point instead of to the zero point. Yeah. And we get a little different projection points, different from a basic DA. But why do we do this? Because Jesus Pastor and Mette Asmild developed a new efficiency measure or inefficiency measures, or better say a new efficiency measure, which they call comprehensive efficiency. Yeah. Which incorporates also the slacks. Yeah, this tau here. These are the optimal input slacks and optimal output slacks. Yes, and they take the relative values and compute the average values. So relative values taking the average value and subtract this from efficiency. Yes? Beta is the optimal value coming from the RDM. Yeah? And you know from directional distance function that 1 minus beta is efficiency, since beta is an inefficient measure. Yeah? And from this efficiency measure, this we subtract the slacks, more or less, or average slacks, average value, mean value of slacks. So, in order to take into account also the slacks, yeah, to account for the slacks. Yeah. So we do not want to ignore it because they're really important, yeah, to us. How do we compute these slacks? Unfortunately, the slacks cannot be taken from the RDM model only. We have to run a second DA estimate, yeah, which is formulated in this way, or we did derive this additive model assuming variable returns to scale from a model in the famous paper by As Milton Pastor, yes, this is simply the estimator in the objective function here. You see the relative input slacks and relative output slacks. Yeah. It's actually a weighted additive model, and the weights are the ranges, output ranges, input ranges, the range of possible adjustments or improvements. Yeah. And we take here again the input-oriented version. Unfortunately, this simple model can be formulated only for variable returns to scale. You see here this constraint. For constant returns to scale, this model would be much more complicated, and since it would be a nonlinear model, and for non-increasing returns to scale, this model is even not defined, or it has not been formulated so far. So, and we could not really figure out how such a model would look like. That's the reason that we base most part of our analysis simply on RDM, and we just compute the comprehensive efficiency measure only for VRS. Yeah. So when we assume VRS. So these are the empirical results, or the first look to this, first summary statistics. You see on average technical efficiency is around 80%, which we can decompose, as I said, into poor technical efficiency, assuming VRS and the well-known scale efficiency. You see here, there's still some room for improvement, since poor technical efficiency around 91%, and there's also some some plants do not operate at optimal scale size, so they can also improve their efficiency in terms of changing their size. Yeah, share of efficient plants are relatively low. You see, we find also plants with relatively low efficient. See, this is just a histogram from which you can see the distribution of efficiency scores, technical efficiency, and poor technical efficiency. For the technical efficiency, we assume CRS. From the poor technical efficiency, of course, variable returns to scale.
What's the main difference between technical efficiency and pure technical efficiency?
Now, yeah, the technical efficiency measured assuming CRS can be decomposed in scale efficiency and poor technical efficiency. And poor technical efficiency is VRS efficiency. Yes, you know, the VRS frontier is much tighter. The envelope is much tighter.
It supports that you have to know beforehand the room for technical improvement in every of the parameters. How do you estimate that? So it was like two tools. One that was the room for improvement for every n parameter that you have in the model you showed. How do you estimate that?
There's room. Thank you for your question. Actually, this range of possible, but this is computed out of based on the observations.
Okay, so you have like an exponential model that it grows for every tau you are using in your summatory.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. This can be this R.
You can also be, have to know the optimal input slacks as.
Yes, we get the optimal input slacks
like
from this second stage model.
So you have to estimate like some optimal in order to calculate another optimal.
Yes.
Okay.
It's like you a see, model. Yes, yes, it's a two-stage model actually. In the first stage, we get this, this beta star,
So it's really like an approximation of the actual bit that you're trying to calculate, and you put it into that model and you try it again. Okay.
Yes, yes. This is really needed since you can get different values of the slacks.
It's kind of dependent on starting conditions, isn't it? It depends on how you choose your beta, you will get.
Sure. But the beta star is. It's a result of the first from the first stage. Yeah. Yes, we could take also the slacks we get here. You see this inequation sign here. So we'd also get the slacks from this. But we tried it, and we really saw that the slacks are different in the we get from the second stage and then slightly different, yeah. And for CRS we tried to use also the slacks we get from a CRS model,
yeah.
But the constant returns to scale, constant returns to scale model. But they were completely useless in this computation, yeah, because they were too large. We got really implausible efficiency scores.
How big is the second term compared to the third one?
It depends on the individual company. I have to look. I mean, if you have time, I can tell you have the results here. But it depends. For efficient efficiently operating firms, this is of course zero. Yeah, because all the constraints are binding. Yeah, and for inefficient, it can be. I mean, for some plants, we did not get any. Slacks are different from zero, and for other plants we got really huge slacks. Yeah, it was really interesting. Yeah, it depends where the projected point is on the frontier. Yeah, and the slacks were too large to ignore it. Yeah, we could not ignore it. Yeah. The estimate would be imprecise then, but as I said, it's we could not solve. So there's this problem for CRS for constant returns. This case, so there's still open question how to simplify the second stage this model for. For CRS and how to formulate it it for non-increasing returns to scale. This is completely open. I hope to have the opportunity to discuss this issue with Jesus Pastor and Mette Asmild once, because I could not figure out from the paper how this can be derived. Yeah. To come back to your question, the technical efficiency as we define it. We define it based on the CRS, on constant returns to scale assumption, covers scale efficiency and poor technical efficiency. Yeah. The scale efficiency is simply the difference between the constant returns to scale frontier and the variable returns to scale frontier. And all plants working on the CRS, for these plants, we say they are so their size is optimal in some sense, that they cannot change their operating efficiency when they change their size. Yeah, but for all of you know the story probably. Yeah, Yeah. For the many plants who where we found scale inefficiency, they can improve by changing the scale. Yeah. So okay, here we have just descriptive statistics showing us that efficiency scores depend on size. We have here three, five size classes below 100 kilowatt, then from 100 kilowatt to 500 kilowatt. This is installed capacity, yeah? And the large ones above 500 kilowatt. And you see, this is the outcome depends from the size, and all the large plants, of course, they work scale efficiently. Efficiently, yes. Whereas the small ones, in the sample of the small ones, we found a number of companies working scale inefficient. And so, but this is the usual story. We can split then the sample into firms operating under increasing returns to scale and constant returns to scale. We do not find anyone working under decreasing returns to scale. This is, yeah. And now we move on more to the political part or to political discussion. The general question here is, what are the effects or what are the relationships between the subsidies they get and the operating efficiency? Operating efficiency, yeah? Or if there is a relationship, then economists, especially from the welfare point of view, say that these subsidies distort a little bit the operators work. Yeah? So if there is an incentive in the sense that the subsidies influence negatively the efficiency of the plants, then the effect is detrimental from the welfare point of view. Yeah? So they have an impact to be, if you want, lazy or to be not so efficient simply. Yeah? Therefore, we do some regression analysis, taking the comprehensive measure of poor technical efficiency based on VRS technology as the dependent variable and different characteristics of the plant itself as well as characteristics of the environment. Yeah? The plant type is such a characteristic. This is it a waste plant, a biomethane injectors, or just an agricultural power gas plant? Yeah? This is one characteristic of the plant. Then the regional conditions differ a little bit across the Austrian states, or may differ. Yeah? Therefore, we have a regional damage here. And other, also the number of the digesters, then a dummy whether they have a gas tight final depot, the size of plant, of course, we measure either in digester volumes or in installed capacity, the loading rate, age of plant, and these two variables are the political one, Yeah, because as I said, we would like to see the relationship between efficiency and production subsidies, which means feed-in tariffs on the one hand, and investment subsidies they got when they or they received from public authorities when they built their plant before they started working. Yes, and these are the results from an TOPIT model, for censored regression model with different versions. As I said, the dependent variable is the poor technical efficiency on a comprehensive efficiency score, and you see that the relationship or the coefficient of the investment subsidies are not robust. Yeah? The difference between model 2 and model 1 is simply the way how we measure the waste, the characteristics whether a plant is a waste plant or an agricultural power gas plant. Yeah? You see, when we take a dummy variable, then the investment subsidy is, or the coefficient is negative, which means that the higher the subsidy was, the lower the operating efficiency is. Yeah? You see this detrimental effect, which is, as I mentioned before, which has some implications in terms of welfare economics, yeah? Which is detrimental. Yeah, and the second set of variables describes the production subsidies measured by the feed-in tariff they get. You should know that the feed-in tariff, the level of feed-in tariff, depends on size, interestingly, since the operating cost depends on size. And the intention by the law is to provide plants of any size a possibility to survive. Therefore, we've seen that we have the process is characterized by returns to scale, which means that production costs for small firms are higher than for medium-sized and large firms, large plants. Yeah? Therefore, the feed-in tariff for small firms is higher than for medium firms and large firms. Yeah? Here, the interesting point here is that we get relatively robust positive coefficients from all versions of regression we tried, and from this, but these coefficients are these coefficients. First of all, these variables are all dummies, and the coefficients decrease as the size of firm increases. Yeah? And from these results, we conclude that the subsidies really they are really correlated with efficiency in a way that the higher the subsidies, the production subsidies, the lower is the level of operating efficiency. Yeah. So it's hard. This is just regression analysis based on cross section, and it's not easy to find a causal relationship, yeah. So it's hard to say whether the feed-in tariff really causes inefficiency. Yeah, this we cannot say, but there is at least efficient and a relationship which supports a little this hypothesis that the subsidies are, the production subsidies may be a negative incentive for, this is a second set of regression which confirms this. So the subsidies may have a negative incentive for plant operators to be efficient. Yeah. So here I'm coming to a summary of our results and to our conclusions. We find significant increasing returns to scale effects, yeah, but no decreasing returns to scale. So as an interesting characterization or characteristic of the process, of the production process in power gas plants. And we found that plants with less or equal than 100 kilowatt hours installed capacity work more or less scale inefficient. Yeah. And the sources of poor technical inefficiency are on the one hand the subsidies, yeah, since high production subsidies may discourage efficiency, yeah, and we do not really find a robust relationship between investment subsidies and efficiency, yeah. A significant negative correlation has been found, but this result is not robust across various models. And yeah, finally we find that plants with gas-tight funnel depot are more efficient, which gives a little hint what gas plant operators can do, how can they improve efficiency, operating efficiency. So I think, yes, so I, yeah, these are the outcomes, more or less, or the conclusions summarized on this slide, and I would be really very grateful for comments, hints from your side.
Why do you think high production subsidies may discourage efficiency? Why, which explanation would you give to that phenomenon?
Well, yeah, we think that that the subsidies provide something like an incentive for the plant operators to be not so efficient. Although it's not, as I said, it's not so easy to say this because the subsidies are also related or correlated with the size of plants. But we took both types of variables with as regressors in our analysis, and across all versions, almost all versions of regression analysis, we do not find a significant significant coefficient for the size variable. So it's that it's more, or it seems to be that the production subsidies are linked to efficiency and not the size. I mean, yeah, you may argue that, well, the size operators, the small size operators, they are not so do not act so professional because they are just small scale firms, and they I cannot concentrate on working on the plant. You should know that many plants are in some sense connected with farms. So actually farmers run the plants, which are not so well educated, which are not specialized. They are educated as farmers, but not as plant operators. For them, this is just a second job. The primary job is their farm work.
The small farm gets less subsidies than the bigger ones in proportion, or in proportion they are the same. That's what I
think. No. They.
If I have a bigger plant, which is more efficient by definition with your criteria, will I get more subsidies in proportion than a smaller one?
No. They get a lower tariff. They get a lower tariff because the production. They know it's very well known that the production costs are lower in large firms. Yeah, and we can confirm this, because we found returns to scale. Yeah, so small firms works in increasing returns to scale, and large firms in the zone of constant returns to scale. Yeah. Yes.
Network, and you know that there are models in the literature to deal with networks. And what do you think?
Yes.
Apply these models in your context, or
yes.
You need more information, you need more
variables? Yeah, you're right. You are right. In principle, you're right. We model the plant as black box here, yeah? But as you say, and I agree with you, that here we have flows of material and energy, and the process consists of different stages, which can be seen as a network, yeah. And naturally, this would be a good example, a good possibility to apply network DA models. Yeah, I think this is what you would like to say here. But unfortunately, we do not have a reliable information about the internal flows of material and energy. Yeah, this is the problem. Yeah, only for a couple of firms these flows are observed continuously. Yeah, as I said, they do not have much equity capital, and they cannot afford good measurement facilities, and therefore the information they know about their own plant is very limited, even for the operators. Yeah, this is a shame. So in some sense, there's a lack of professional knowledge and human capital and manpower in this sector, which is another reason for inefficiency and for lack of competitiveness. Yeah, but maybe in the future, when the law about the guaranteed fees expires, then they are forced, they have incentives to concentrate more on working and to get more trainings about this, to improve simply the way how they operate it, and also the information that they collect about the process and so on and so forth. Yeah. Yes, this might be one effect of this. Yeah.
The difference in prices from the market, I think it was something like 4 cents, something like that. And from the suit.
You see, yeah, the average feed-in tariff they get is around 18 cents per kilowatt hours, and right now the average wholesale
so they have 13 prices. Years to find another job.
Yes.
Yeah, basically.
Yeah.
What is the subsidy scheme in all these small firms? Everyone is funded separately, or is like some common funded field for research and development or something like that? Or if I build my small plant, I will get a subsidy independent of all the other small plants.
Yes, yes.
That's,
yes.
I think that's the way that the model is intrinsically not efficient in when sparing all the subsidies you have to give to all the farmers. The mainly source of inefficiency was the scale. If you are funding only the smaller ones separately, you will always get more efficiently funding the bigger ones that are the
problem. Yes, yes, exactly, that's the problem. Yeah, that's the case.
You have to make like some kind of cartel or something like that, you know, that's able to share the technical improvements that your fees are enabling to make.
Yeah, yeah.
Otherwise, you are competing in another scale completely different.
Yes, yes, you're right. The farms are, in some sense, or the firms, the operators are in some sense organized within, how is it exactly called, in an agency, Austrian Compost and Biogas Association, but this is just an association which provides information, but also which represents the branch vis-a-vis the public authorities when they negotiate about different framework conditions. Yeah? And they also organize meetings where operators get together to exchange ideas and information about new trends, innovations, technical innovations. But in reality, the operators do not really attend these meetings. They only a couple of them participate. And they are not so open when they exchange, so they are in some sense a little narrow-minded. They are not so ready. They think, well, then my neighbor should not know too much about my own plant and so how it works and so on and so on. So they keep things secret. But this is not. It would be more beneficial if they cooperate, exchange information, give them hints. Like we do here in these seminars, researcher, we go to meetings, seminars like this, and show details of our analysis and ask for hints and what do you think, what you do, have an idea, do you have something, and you give me comments, but the operators do not do this. Yeah, they keep the many information secret, and they are not really willing to participate and also to attend something like vocational trainings, specialized to their field of profession and so on. This is, yeah.
You're paying for the same thing over and over. You're funding all the research and development of the small farmers, and everyone is is not talking with the others, you are paying for the same stuff over and over. You won't never be, you will never be efficient.
Yes, I agree with you. I agree with you. Yeah.
Some conditions to those subsidies is they only paying for doing anything. You are not incentive to share your research or to do anything useful with the subsidies.
Yes, you're right. Are you okay? If I understand you right, you suggest that the subsidies should be connected.
It's like trying to minimize the inefficiency brought by the scale conditions of the business.
Yeah.
Like grouping all the small firms and make some joint R&D resources and found that.
Yes.
They are compelled to share all their research, so at least in this area you won't be penalized for your margin costs.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
If I have a farm with only 5 people working there and I get some R&D, I've got my department of R&D and it's just 20% of my people. Well, okay, you have one person that is founded and is trying to make improvements in your competitivity, but if you have a big firm like with 100 people, you will have 20 of them doing that.
Mm-hmm.
So if you join all the R&D of the small ones, you will get like a bigger department that you can directly fund, and all the information and accomplishments of that department
yes.
will be spread among
yes.
all the
yes.
small farmers.
Yeah, yeah, I agree completely. But this is the general issue here, so the general problem is that, as I said, they are not very, very funded. And what's the, in some sense, what the public authorities do, they subsidize research and development. The project I'm working for is something like that. Yeah, it's funded by the an agency, a public agency supporting applied research. Yeah. And the whole project is not only about about doing this research, but also to transferring new. Insights, also transferring this type of results into the sector, to the plant. So for example, they ask me doing something, or my colleagues, which are technicians, yeah, to do some optimization, yeah, or to give them advice at least, then they pay only very little, yeah, or to do something, yeah. So these services are subsidized as well in order to help, yeah. But even these very cheap services are not so much demanded, yeah. This is very strange. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Okay.
Thanks. Okay.